So we're going to call ourselves to order. The first agenda item is public comment. The chair requests that there be no public comment on issues for which a prior public hearing has been held before the Board of Directors. Please note that the public will have an opportunity to speak on specific items on the Metro Vision Plan between the staff presentation and committee discussion. Is there anybody that wishes to address the board this evening? Seeing nobody, we'll move on to agenda item three. Agenda item three is a summary of the July 1, 2015 meeting. Any additions, deletions, or changes to the summary of the meeting? Okay, seeing none. Before we go on to the action item, a couple of things. First of all, I want to recognize that Denver has a new alternate, and I wanted to recognize Councilmember Kevin Flynn. The new regular member is Robin Kanich, and the alternate is Kevin Flynn. So, Kevin, if you could raise your hand. And all right, so we have one action item this evening, discussion of 2040 Metro Vision Plan, and I want to preface this by a couple of things. First of all, lucky Herb, Mayor Atchison, because I have to leave early this evening. So I will start the meeting, and Herb will end the meeting. So if you guys stay till midnight, that's fine. No, no. We have been having a hard stop at 6 because of the constraints of this room. And so, I mean, if Herb takes it past 6, that's his business. But that's what we've been doing, is a hard stop at 6. The other thing that I wanted to point out is, if you look at the agenda item itself, I just wanted to point out what our objective is this evening. So in attachment 2, there are three columns. There's the overarching theme and outcome, the objectives, and the objective narrative. What our goal this evening is to work through just column 1. So we want to work on, discuss, and come to consensus, if possible, on all of the overarching themes and outcomes in column 1. I would encourage you not to read ahead into column 2 and column 3, because we want to get column 1 complete, get consensus on column 1, and then we will move into columns 2 and 3. So our goal this evening is to get through 16 items in column 1. Now, what's going to happen at the next meeting is, and this will be probably reemphasized later on in this meeting, is we really need everybody at the September meeting to read the material ahead of time, be prepared for kind of a deep dive discussion. And what's going to happen is that staff is going to give us dots. I'm sure that in different sessions you've done this before, but we're going to be talking then about the objectives. And we're going to, each board member is going to have a certain number of dots, and you can put dots on the things that you feel are the most important for us to discuss. The idea here is that if there are things that have no dots, we don't need to spend any time on them. Or if out of 26 members there's one dot, we probably won't spend any time on it. So that's the objective, is that we will, at the next meeting, we'll be prepared to discuss the items under the column objectives. We'll be given dots, and we'll have an opportunity to express with those dots what items are most important to us. Everybody got understand that works for everybody? Okay. Commissioner Partridge.
Mr. Chair, I'm just going to, it's going to come up later, the word consensus. So I think even if one member has something to discuss, I think we as a body should take that forward. I'll just make that comment.
Okay. And I think one of the things that we've talked about in previous meetings is that consensus is not necessarily unanimity. So, but I understand your point. Thank you. Right.
Mr. Chair, I differ. Maybe we can look up the definition of consensus.
Okay. I think what we'll do is there is a definition of consensus decision making, and I'll just hand this around, and if we want to discuss it further, we certainly can. So what I want to do, I'm sorry, Mayor Pro Tem Millay, did you have? Oh, okay. So what I want to do at this point is we do have two staff members that are kind of facilitate this conversation. So I'm going to start out by handing it over to Jerry and let him move forward with our conversation.
Brad, I think, was going to tee up a few things for us. I'm going to try to help you through the process of looking at these outcomes, these themes and outcomes. And Brad's going to just cover a couple of things in the setup.
So I will, as Jerry mentioned, I'm just going to sort of quickly kind of walk you through a few setup pieces just really to get the discussion started. As the memo noted, this is really kind of the official kickoff of MVIC's really sort of full review of the draft Metro Vision Plan. You have, over the last 6 months, seen every single overarching theme. You've also been given a draft of the full document. So everything has kind of come through you once. You had a not so brief detour into foundational measures and to performance measures, but now we're going to sort of take a step back and think a little bit more globally about sort of the overarching outcomes, which Jerry discussed last time, is really kind of the very key piece and strategy going sort of from the left to right pieces, as he mentioned last month. So there's a lot in the packet. Just so that you know what everything is, obviously there's a memo in there. Jerry's going to spend a little bit of time again on a sort of quick refresh on the strategic planning model, which is attachment one. The discussion document, the main thing that we're going to spend time on is really attachment two, so I think that is your primary cheat sheet. I think the chair did a good job of reminding you that really what we're focusing on is that first left-hand most column. So try to avoid reading ahead, but I know sometimes it's just kind of hard to do that. Last month we talked to you, particularly Jerry talked to you about the relationship between the draft Metro Vision Plan and Dr. Cog's overall strategic planning efforts, and took that draft plan document, one overarching theme, and sort of provided you that sort of linear document. And so we've given you every particular, all five overarching themes are now in your packet. So those are all those 11 by 17s. We won't spend a lot of time on that today, but I think it's just good resource material for you to have later. The board saw an overall adoption schedule last month, and so we just included that in your packet. And also attachment five includes comments received by board members or board alternates specifically on the overarching themes and outcomes, just so that you have those in front of you. As we roll forward and get to objectives and actions and things like that, we will do the same thing. We will circle back and share with you things that have been discussed about in these committees, or things that we've received in writing from your colleagues. So again, this is the primary discussion item. As was mentioned, we've tried to kind of color code this a little bit, so hopefully you're not colorblind, or these aren't the colors that impact folks that are colorblind. There really are kind of three types of text in here. There's black text, green text, and red text. The black text really just means this concept was present in Metro Vision 2035 and has been carried over into the draft Metro Vision plan. What edits have happened to the text have been really minor and typically just to add clarification. So an example from the from outcome number three, there is an objective in the urban centers element about promoting diverse housing options, and then the sort of supporting narrative to the side. This was lifted almost entirely from the existing Metro Vision plan. A little bit of tweaks here and there for clarity, but it really is a carryover from the previously adopted plan. Something in green is really refers to a concept that was present in the previous adopted version of the plan, but you know, some level of tweaking happened that you know could come to the conclusion that it was substantive in some way. So, for instance, using the same page from attachment 2, you know, we've always, for frankly, in the last Metro Vision plan and every plan before it, there's been this sort of policy directive to try to direct new housing and employment into urban centers. And there's also always been this idea that these places are unique, right? Even though we talk about urban centers as a collective, they are unique. But really, the plan was amended to really emphasize that this time around. So we talk about that uniqueness also means that not all urban centers are going to be able to absorb population and employment growth in the same way that maybe their neighbors are. So it really was explicitly added this time around. So that's the type of thing that, again, was present but was substantively addressed during this rewrite. So we thought it important to call that sort of thing out. And then again, the red text are things that we consider new to this draft. We did our best not to come in and color just a couple of words red, but there were a few occasions where, again, this exact same outcome during the stakeholder engagement efforts, there really was an emphasis on sort of a confirmation that, yes, urban centers are really central to our overall growth framework as a region, but we also need to be thinking about multimodal corridors, places that can support a variety of travel, whether that's transit, bike, ped, auto, et cetera. And so just that those two words to me sort of were substantive enough and new enough that they got called out in red text. And then here's an example of something that really wasn't present in the previous plan, and this is also something that came up, again, during stakeholder engagement efforts, was if we are going to talk about centers and corridors, recognize that oftentimes these places are competing for a market share of things like retail development, and so be thinking of that. Don't have these places cannibalize each other. If you really want to add retail to a center, you've got to be thinking about how retail gets treated on the corridor that maybe is a half mile, three quarters of a mile away. So this is something that really is a concept is new in the Metro Vision draft that you have in front of you. So as Jerry mentioned, we're going to tag team this a little bit today. He's going to spend a little bit of time again on the strategic framework, he's largely going to assist the chairs, I suppose, with meeting facilitation, just so that there are a couple people with eyeballs on what people are looking to talk about. I'm obviously here for content questions, and then when we get into actually talking about outcomes, I will be the one that's sort of trying to make the changes on the fly and having them on the screen so that this group can hopefully, again, come to consensus, however this group chooses to define that, on something that they feel like is ready to move forward. So you've all seen these, and you're wondering what these are. They're really to help the chair out. They're to help the chair kind of get a good read of the room as this group is talking about something. These things are actually called like menu clips, and I think that's appropriate because this idea was really kind of stolen from restaurants around the region. When this is in here, does that mean they're going to bring you a lot more sopapillas or steak? What it really means is, it means, by and large, you're good with whatever's on the screen, right? If we're talking about outcome one, if you were fine with it as written, you could go ahead and have your gold sheet up now. If you really feel like you want to keep discussing this item and you don't think it's ready to move forward, you would not display your gold sheet. So in some ways, that may be your default position. It's not to really unnecessarily accelerate the conversation. It's really just to give the chair a good visual cue. We've got a lot of folks here tonight, a read of the room, as to how people are thinking about this issue. So we'll give this a try this evening and we'll see just how it works.
And let me elaborate on one piece to that. Is we talked earlier about, you know, if somebody feels like that that they're good with the issue and they're ready to personally not discuss it anymore, that doesn't necessarily mean that they agree with it. So as the chair, once it looks like we kind of have the majority of the room that wants to move forward, I am going to make the attempt, or Mayor Atchison will make the attempt in my absence, to frame what it is that we are moving forward on, so that we can make sure that we've got 20 people that have their placards up. Then the chair will make sure that they kind of frame what it is that we're moving forward with, and make sure that that is what the room is in agreement on. Okay.
So with that, Jerry, I'll kick it back over to you.
Thank you. Thanks, Brad. Can you hear me okay from here? All right, great. I did want to do a little review of this model, just get everybody back on the same page, and I've added a couple pieces. This is the standard model that we presented, the mission, vision, strategic perspectives, and so forth. So let me just cover the top. You know, mission is about purpose. Vision is about a view of the future. I'm going to skip the perspectives piece. It's a balanced scorecard term. But let's go back to overarching themes and outcomes. Those are our destination points. Those are the, what you could conclude, are the value-based aspirational goals, if I could use that additional term, that you will determine as a board. And as Bob said right off, these are so critical to everything else in that model. If we don't get the outcomes squared away well, it's going to affect how we design objectives. That's going to affect how we design measures, which will affect how we identify and design strategic initiatives. That's one slight edit I'd like to suggest, is that last term, moving from action strategies and just call it strategic initiatives that capture a broad array of projects and things of that nature. So when we start with the overarching theme and outcome, we're talking about the end or destination point we want to arrive at. But that's a long-term outcome. It's not only long-term, it's what Jim Collins, if you've read Good to Great, would call a BHAG, big, hairy, audacious goal. So you've got to figure out a way that you can break that down. And so objectives allow you to do that. Objectives are the continuous improvements or continuous improvement activities that lead to that outcome. We've heard conversations in this committee about aspirational or achievable. They are both. Your outcomes are aspirational, value-based, because we care if people have clean air and have good health. That's a value-based. But the objectives are to be accomplished. Those can be achieved. So those objectives work you toward that outcome. And it's something that operationalizes your strategy that you could actually activate. The next piece is called a strategy map, and that's a visual display of all those objectives that make a strategic story. I'm going to just go past that. Eventually we will bring one to you to show, but it is a key piece of explaining your strategy. Once we've determined objectives, which are continuous improvement activities, we start to look at those objectives and ask the question, what's the best evidence of us achieving that objective? And we list a few statements that we believe would come to our knowledge, come to fruition, and from those statements we can extract some measures. I'm guessing you probably haven't approached it that way, but in looking at some of the measures, they seem to still be aligned with the objectives and outcomes pretty well. Well, the targets now, let me just kind of separate that a little bit. That is establishing our desired level of performance. So if the performance measure tells us how we're performing, the target tells us how we're performing against that target. And so, you know, targets should not be arbitrary, but they should be and should be well thought out. But targets are important for measures to determine how you're progressing. And then the last piece are those projects that you would decide and vote on that will drive those objectives toward that outcome. So as Bob was saying, focusing on that far left column right now on outcomes is really key. Some of you have heard me make the statement, and as I talk to people about strategy, they'll start talking about what they're doing, and that's at the bottom of that triangle. What I would suggest is that, you know, it's better to understand what you want to accomplish before you understand what you want to do. So the accomplishment piece would be the outcomes, and that's what I would recommend. We start and run those vertically and make sure they're viable and they're written in the way that you like and think they, you know, represent what you want, and then we move to the next piece. Okay? You can flip one more slide. And now your second handout is identical, except I've plugged in the DRCOG mission just to give you an example of what that would look like in that component, vision, all the way down through strategic initiatives, some examples of those. Okay. This last slide is that linear format. As you'll see, it's similar to what's in your packet. This was given out at the last INVIC meeting, so it starts with themes, outcomes, the objectives, performance measures, targets, and what I would recommend we call strategic initiatives as opposed to action strategies. All right? So what questions would you have about that construct or that model that I could answer? Doing okay? All right. If you have any questions about it, where we are, what it means, please let me know. We'll address it as we go. Okay, the first, in the very first outcome then, I would suggest in attachment two, you have two pieces of information, really. That's the outcome itself and the narrative below. If you would take a few minutes to read that, first question I would like to ask, is that outcome viable? That's the first question.
Any initial comments or suggestions? Mayor Pro Tem Millay.
I'm just wondering why we don't just say diverse livable communities and leave it there. That's the outcome. I mean, because the rest of it is implied, and I'm not sure what lifestyle options actually mean. If they're diverse livable communities, they're open and available to everyone.
Jerry?
Key point, because I have gone through these to look at some of those, and lifestyle options, if you use it, would need to be defined. I mean, if you're going to measure something, this is the problem with outcome statements. Often they're written almost at like graduate level, and they should be focused around 10-year-old that a 10-year-old could understand it. So lifestyle options would need to be defined clearly before we could measure that. So to Jackie's point, yeah.
So my recommendation would be to just take offer a continuum of lifestyle out.
Mr. Graves.
I agree with Mayor Pro Tem Millay.
Jerry.
Sorry, I would also bring up two more words.
Please.
Diverse livable. You know, I don't want to sound like I'm nitpicking, but does everyone have the same view of diverse? No? Don says? Yeah, it's more likely not. I hate to say it. That's what narratives do for you. They help you define some of these terms. So diverse livable, you'd want to parse out those words. What are we talking about when we say diverse? And it may seem like you're really getting down to nit stuff, but it's so essential to move on to the other components.
So we're left with communities.
No.
Mayor, I think that works.
Mayor Pro Tem Millay.
I guess in my mind, the narrative speaks to diverse and livable. So
okay, good.
That is.
That cover it? Good.
But now I'm not saying I agree with the definition, but to me, diverse livable communities are what are discussed in the narrative, and I do think we should have a discussion about that narrative.
Absolutely.
But that, to me, is the place where diverse and livable is defined.
It would have to be, correct.
Other comments, or Commissioner Sharp?
Just one thing is that it says downtown areas to suburban communities as well as freestanding cities and towns, yet under our overarching theme number 4, we talk about rural town centers, and they're not included in this. So
I'll ask Brad to respond to that, if you don't mind. Thank you.
Well, I mean, I can simply just... is the suggestion, I don't know if you're making a suggestion, but we can say towns, or we can say just rural town centers there, if that feels like the right change.
I think there's a difference between, as in this document, there's a difference between freestanding cities and towns and rural town centers. So I think they should be included.
Mayor Cernanek.
Just being the Nick, following the nitpicking model that Jerry put out there, freestanding cities, do we have a common understanding of what freestanding means?
It is defined later in the document and listed.
Do you want to comment?
Yeah, I mean, to Elisa's point, I mean, it's defined later as to what they are, right?
Do we reference it here? I mean, that's...
Yes. The freestanding communities are there's a specific outcome associated with those, and particularly the growth and development supplement, which is a paired complement to this, to Metro Vision, describes precisely what freestanding communities are.
Oh, All I was looking at is we're focused on column one, so I'm trying to be consistent within this, which is looking down column one.
Yes.
Page six.
So one suggestion is the possibility of having staff come up with a list of definitions that would be associated with this document. Commissioner Sharp.
I'm going to challenge the freestanding later on, so it may come back, and that's just one thing that I think if we go through, as we go through the document, if something later on is not included, I think we have to go back to through the document and see where it might appear.
Okay.
So I think it will, as we go through the document, I think we need to go back and look.
Okay.
For consistency.
Commissioner Partridge.
Realizing being from county, we do not have cities and towns under county jurisdiction. So when you say free town, freestanding cities and towns, that is eliminating the county's land use.
Mayor Pro Tem Millay.
In my mind, this really isn't about naming every type of community that we have within the region. It's about embracing the fact that we've got diverse urban, rural, and suburban communities. And the idea is that we want to allow the breadth of all of that, and that's what makes this region so unique and creative. So in my mind, the Denver metro region will continue to embrace its diverse urban, rural, and suburban communities. And that's really what needs to be said here. Now, not every single rural community is homogeneous, just like every urban community and suburban. So that's the point, right? We're all different and unique and great and special in our own ways, and we don't want to be homogeneous. So that would be my recommendation for an edit there, to take out ranging from urban downtown areas to suburban communities and freestanding, and just put in diverse urban, rural, and suburban communities.
Sold.
To the lady in the orange dress.
Councilmember Kniech. So
is
if people want to
when Brad makes
indicate
that
with
edit.
Their placards, and we can,
I can't remember.
For those who want to continue on, we can continue on.
Wait, it's up if we're done.
So once the edits, I guess they'll focus on this as a final, is that right? Sort of the next
sentence.
Yeah, so once Brad makes the edits, we can look at that and see if that suffices.
So seeing a lot of agreement around the table, what I would like to do is take Jerry's suggestion and have everybody just take a moment and read through that and make sure that we're happy with the way that's been altered.
We're glad. I'll share that with you later.
Mayor Noon.
So did we decide we're going to define diverse and livable, or we're going to just live with it the way it is? I just thought I heard that in the beginning, so I wasn't sure.
Mayor Pro Tem Millay.
I think we're not finished with this. I think the livable portion is the next sentence. To me, diverse, I would argue that just means a range of options. So would Metro have a range of unique, instead of diverse, I would say we could have a range of unique urban, suburban, and rural communities. I don't know. Diverse to me is pretty self-explanatory. I'm okay with leaving it, I guess.
I don't necessarily have a problem if it's just brought up. I just want to make sure before I say yay or nay that that's what you meant.
And the only reason I bring it up is because we just need a common view. What's that?
Nothing.
Because I'm a pain? Is that what you said? I'm sorry. Well,
never.
I knew that.
Never, Jerry.
Is that we, having a unified view of that term is important, so we could parse that out if necessary.
Councilmember Thiel.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So as far as that second sentence is concerned, the only one that being from a suburban and a freestanding community, the only one that concerns me a little bit is the integration of multimodal transportation choices. Multimodal transportation choices are very difficult for Castle Rock. It's great within the town, but it's very difficult as a freestanding community outside of the town to go from outside of the town. Therefore, can we do something along the lines of multimodal transportation choices where feasible.
Commissioner Jones.
I guess I would argue against that. We're creating a regional vision. We're not mandating anything. Multimodal means different modes. It doesn't necessarily mean transit. It means bike, ped. There are different ways to get around Castle Rock. And we're looking at the region as a whole and not saying that every single place in the region will have, say, transit, but as the region as a whole. So I don't think I don't think we need to put in where feasible, but I think Castle Rock fits into that well. So I say we're pretty close to being done with.
Councilmember Teal.
Well, doesn't your argument kind of cut the legs out from that first sentence we agreed on? Because you're basically saying, don't worry about Castle Rock. It's okay. It really is fine. Whereas, as a representative of Castle Rock, I would tell you that, no, it's not. I mean, it's very difficult to have multimodal transportation choices. So if we really are being inclusive, again, we're feasible. Just understanding the fact that it's not, we don't have just last mile challenges. We have last, what was the old Roman word? We have last league challenges in Castle Rock.
I've got several in the queue. First of all, I want to clarify, Councilmember Stolzman, did you have your hand up? Go ahead, please.
Yeah, thank you. I think because it says transportation choices, I think it's fine without where feasible, because multimodal includes cars, it includes whatever choices you can make in your community, and choices doesn't necessarily mean you can afford to do something today or that you're going to not do something in the future. You're choosing how people get around, and so I don't think this says anything about the feasibility at all, just what you choose in your community, as diverse as it is, to make it livable, whenever you choose to do that. So I would leave it without the words where feasible.
Okay, I have four in the queue. I've got Cernanik, Malay, Jones, and then Sharp. Mayor Cernanik.
Granted, I think we can probably come up with a pretty good definition of what multimodal might be. I'm just going to throw out an alternate word that was used in the preamble of the March draft, which was rather than saying multimodal, successful integration of balanced transportation choices, and that's borrowing from the preamble.
Mayor Pro Tem Malay.
I guess I'm looking at this a little bit differently, and what I have a concern with is successful integration of balanced or multimodal transportation choices, because that's not going to be available to all of the communities. To me, we want a varied varied housing and transportation options, because to me this has to apply to all of our diverse communities. I don't think rural communities are ever going to be multimodal, but what they should have is transportation options. So varied housing and transportation options, access to employment. We're not going to name every kind of job or employer we're going to have there, so we don't need to name every type of transportation we're going to have. A range of services. You know, I'm assuming that's health, human services, and recreation opportunities. We're not going to say swimming, boating, hiking, recreation. So why don't we just say a range of housing and transportation? It will mean different things in our urban centers than it will mean in our rural communities. And I think if we're talking about diverse, livable communities, successful integration of multimodal transportation is not going to happen in every single one of those communities.
Commissioner Jones. No? Okay. I'm sorry. Well, never mind then.
Well, I guess I want to, this is our regional vision, 2040, what we aspire, what we're trying to create. We're not defining the status quo. We're painting in broad brush how we want our region to grow so that all good things come to all people, right? So I guess I feel like we're trying to describe what we have now. And we're trying to paint the picture of what the region might look like in 2040. And so I want to sort of discourage us from sort of picking this part and going down to a level where we're not talking with aspiration about ideally what we have. And I and the reason I said I think Castle Rock should be okay with it is because I think multimodal the words options in there talk about the fact that we're going to have different things in different communities based on what that community needs and wants and is able to do. So I think that's already in there. So I don't think that this is a problem. But I also, again, 2040 is what we're shooting for, not tomorrow or today.
Commissioner Sharp.
I was just going to suggest that if we say varied housing and transportation options, or we can debate multimodal more, access to employment, range of services, recreational opportunities, then delete all the way down, excuse me, that will promote livable communities. So, So try that. I mean, you can make it multimodal transportation, but transportation options, and that's bike, I mean, I guess we can consider walking a transportation mode. But then it takes out the multimodal. Is that better?
Councilmember Teal.
Yes, Nancy, it is. I like it. And you know, to Elise, I mean, I totally respect what you're trying to say, but let's go back to what the first sentence we agreed to. We're talking about embracing the diverse urban, suburban, and rural communities in 2040. We're not describing today. We're describing having rural communities in 2040. Therefore, I really like the edits that we just made. I completely support what we heard from Jackie. I really like Nancy's edit because I really think that does kind of constrain it. I mean, constrain is not the right way. It focuses that sentence to say that we are embracing what works for urban, suburban, but also rural communities.
Councilmember Plass.
I got it.
Are you messing with me, George?
So I have real concerns about the last strikeout, the successful integration of multimodal transportation choices. So I'll wait and see what's coming, but is there anything else coming after that? Okay. Because I think that's a really important piece of what we're talking about here and what the regional vision needs to be. And so I have real concerns about that. And as far as Castle Rock goes, I mean, I think that different communities can implement multimodal in different ways. And it doesn't necessarily have to be regional. It could be within your community. It could be as simple as promoting sidewalks and bike opportunities, I think. So I was fine. I actually think it's really important to leave the multimodal transportation choices in there. So I have trouble with taking it out.
Councilmember Quinn.
Thank you. Well, I understand the concerns expressed by Castle Rock. I think there's some unnecessary fear of the term multimodal transportation. It has a commonly defined definition as a type of planning that considers different modes of transportation like bike, auto, transit, etc., and the connections between them. I don't think it's something that's threatening. It's a term that we planners use on a daily basis. We all know what it means. So I guess I'm not quite sure where that fear comes from of a term that already has a well-defined meaning.
Councilmember Teal.
Hey, I'm a tough guy. I can speak to my fears. It's really not fear, but I'm just trying to make both sentences honest with each other. I mean, make sense against each other. So, sorry to inject fear into the conversation. It's more just along the lines of we're saying at the top, we're going to embrace the diversity of urban, suburban, rural communities. I like precisely what we have right here. I already flipped my card, just because I think we can have a good balance. I have two good, balanced, and honest sentences.
Commissioner Partridge.
Pose a question just when you look at varied housing and transportation. Varied housing, I ask ourselves, does that pretty well explain all different housing choices we have? So why does not varied follow along with the various transportation choices? I think we say it. Varied houses, varied housing and transportation options. I think it covers it all.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem Malay.
Hey, George, the only thing you have to fear is fear itself. So I actually think this language is embraces all options and opportunities for urban, suburban, and rural. I think very transportation, as Commissioner Partridge said, does encompass that, and it doesn't preclude. I think as we get into the discussions of our urban centers is where we will be more specific about multimodal, because that's probably using that language. This language has to apply to a rural community as well as it applies to an urban area. And in my mind, varied transportation options apply equally to both. And I don't know if you need, I'm not sure the process here, so maybe does the card up mean that you're good with the edit the way it is? And
well, let me
interject. I'm not sure that everyone is.
Let me interject something real quick, and I'll answer that question. The goal, and I'm not in any way discouraging discussion until everybody's satisfied with where we are, but the goal at the beginning of the meeting was to try to get through 16 items. We've not gotten through one, and we're 45 minutes into a two-hour meeting. So I'm not sure. You know, we can take as much time as we need to, but we're going to be numerous meetings in at this rate. So again, I'm not discouraging conversation. I'm just making a point. So Mayor Pro Tem Malay, yes, the idea was if you have your placard showing that you are reasonably satisfied with the edits the way they are and you can live with them and move forward, and I am seeing the majority of the table with their placard showing, unless somebody has strong objection, I would like to move to the next item. Jerry?
Oh, I was going to say, this happens a lot, and I know you guys have been into wordsmithing a lot. We have a phrase we use in balanced scorecard work called, and it goes like this, we shouldn't spend 3 hours changing happy to glad. Okay? And, yeah, well, I was trying to wait to see how I was going to pan out. But, I mean, truly, it does take, and sometimes the way certain things are written makes that wordsmithing just gives it legs. I mean, gives it life. So to get it down as crisp as you can, and if I were to, you know, you could pull out even will. You could pull out some of those words and make them, you're there? Are you sure? All right. We're good. Okay. Next one. Good review, and we'll start there.
Now that Bob took 45 minutes.
Thank you, Bob.
Yeah. Jerry, would you have staff start the dinner orders, please?
Yes, I would. Well, I have one at 6:30 at
McDonald's.
Birthday, so I might want to make that one. My daughter's birthday, so. 22. Can't miss that. Okay, so we have outcome. If you would review that, and is it a viable outcome? And if so, do we need to make any changes?
Commissioner Sharp.
I'd like to sort of challenge the word prevent unnecessary. What does unnecessary mean? By whose definition is unnecessary? I think it should be taken out. I don't know what that means. Unnecessary to whom? I can see efficiency in road extensions and that type of thing, but
Commissioner, could I ask a process question? So are you okay with the way the outcome's written?
Oh.
Is that okay?
Yes, I did not.
That's all right. We're, you know.
Since nobody said anything, I moved down.
Oh, that's okay. That's all right. You know, we don't play by the rules always. We just kind of move it around a little bit here.
I'm generally not in favor of, I'm going on record here, that this, I think there are a lot of problems with UGB, UGA, based on our county's just requests that we made, and but that may fall more into some of how you get it processed than anything else. So I will hold that, but I'm not sure I agree with this outcome, but I think probably everybody else in the room probably would, or most everybody. So.
Okay, let me move on. Commissioner Partridge.
Mr. Sharp, I think you might bring this up, but I will bring it up. I'm going to go back to the first sentence, because I just want to ask the question, and this is, you know me, I like details, I like definitions, and I go back to the urban growth boundary. And I think it's very worthy of a discussion here for us to understand that, is to say, and maybe Jennifer can speak to this, but I would like to know how the UBA is agreed upon with DRCOG. What binds us to it? How is it done?
Well, obviously, it is a voluntary growth management program that this region has had since the very first Metro Vision Plan. And so really, the board has a conversation about the long-term urban footprint that this region should have going forward. The thing that I think sometimes people don't necessarily see is ultimately every community owns your own urban growth boundary or area, right? So the process that will happen, presuming we head down this path, is that every community around, every member of DRCOG will say to the board of directors what they anticipate their growth needs are out to the year 2040, and the board makes a collective decision as to whether that they feel like that is appropriate or not. And there's a series of things that happen based on that decision, but I don't know if that's how much detail you want. So
I've been in office 2.5 years, and I haven't been asked yet once yet. So that's why I say, what binds this board to the UBA that is defined at present? What binds us to it?
This board is in many ways, this board / the region is the owner of the UGBA.
All right.
Right.
So
as well as every local government that participates in the program.
So I'm going to ask anybody, has anybody in this room defined the UBA in their community?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. It has, I gotta say, has it been brought to this board? What is the UBA? And I realize, too, is it, I'm going to ask, is it by the Mile High Compact? Is that, so I think there's some gray areas, and I just want definition of the UBA, because I can say Douglas County has not brought that forward.
So it is mentioned in the Mile High Compact, and the board took specific action to delay the UGBA allocation process until after Metro Vision is adopted. So that is why over the past 3 or 4 years there has been no regional allocation process to ask local communities what their future growth needs are.
Then why are we having it brought up now? If you say the UBA has not been brought up to date, how can we address it?
Okay. I'm not sure how we can answer that sitting here, but your question is noted. Is that for at least for now? Is that our answer?
Well, I think we can.
I don't know that we can give you a clear answer for what you're looking for, but the question is stated.
Right. Yeah. And so then I ask the question, how can we discuss outcome two?
All right. I've got about 5 of you, and I think I've got everybody, and Nancy, I just picked up yours, so I think I'm putting Roger off for just a second. Robin, I had you next, then Elise, then Commissioner Sharp, so Ms. Yeah. Kanish, if you would.
I mean, I just want to see if I can help, which is that it's kind of like when you took office with a ton of rules and laws that had already been adopted prior to your entering office, and that's when, you know, you don't get re-asked to reapprove your charter, to reapprove all of the ordinances and things, and so that's, I think it was previously adopted by this body, and we've seen the vote totals. I mean, in some cases, most of those were unanimous. So it's kind of like we come into office, and we're bound by all the things that were adopted before us unless we make changes. So that's the way that I think all of our governments work. You know, I don't get the municipal code plopped in front of me and say, re-adopt. It exists unless you make a change. And so that's my best comparison on that point. But I wanted to go back to the language.
Could I respond to that one thing? A present board is not bound by a previous board's decision.
It's not true with adopted law. It's budgets are annually adopted, but prior law.
Even agreements, there is a large part. Talk to your attorneys.
I'm a licensed attorney.
And I think this has even been said, as I understand, by Dr. Cog's attorney regarding UBA. We cannot bind that legally. It's a previous board. So you are not bound. A present board can change a previous board's decision on many things.
Can change. That's different than not being bound by. Very, very, very different. So, and I, you know, as an attorney, I would suggest this is easily clarified with, you know, it doesn't have to be from me, but you are bound until you change. So, but the language question, I just wanted to suggest an edit. So, to respond to Commissioner Sharp's concern, which is to, beginning with the word prevent, do a strike through to the end of the sentence and replace it with promote more efficient resource allocations for infrastructure. So I agree. I think it seems totally appropriate to phrase it in the positive rather than the negative. So I was going to make that proposed edit. So promote more efficient resource allocations for infrastructure. And then the only other comment I will make is that in terms of this entire piece, I'll just remind folks again about the this. I think this is a really good description or narrative because it very much reflects what was tested in the scenario analysis both this time and last time. So we've kind of tested this, and it tests out in the way that it's written here. So anyway, thanks.
All right, my next one up that I have is Commissioner Jones.
So I actually like Nancy Sharp and Robin's edits. I would support it as is. I want to remind folks a couple of things. One is this talks about the idea of having a defined urban growth boundary. Any what that boundary looks like in the future, policies to how it be allocated, et cetera, and so forth, will all be decided in the next discussion that we have after Metro Vision, as we've planned all along, and that's as it should be. This concept is sort of the heart and soul of a lot of what Metro Vision has been about, and it's the notion of being of planning and being thoughtful about having development occur in a logical planned way so that you're spending less on infrastructure. And I think, Robin, you mentioned the scenarios. When Dr. Cog did its scenario planning last, every metric that was looked at, water quantity, air quality, taxpayer dollars for infrastructure, traffic congestion, et cetera, does better if you have a planned, compact growth pattern that goes out in a logical sequence and pace. So I guess I would support keeping this outcome largely intact with the two edits that we're proposing.
Mr. Sharp.
Thank you. I have a couple of additional suggestions, but one of the concerns that I have here is the flaw with respect to when cities, as they do, and I don't have an objection to cities annexing into unincorporated parts of counties. I don't have a problem with that. But in order for a county to maintain its urban growth area or boundary, we now have to ask permission from the city through an IGA that does not exist and probably would not be granted to give that up. So now counties are we're not on equal footing. We are on a disadvantage, and I think that's a primary problem with what I have with this urban growth boundary and area. If we're going to maintain this in Metro Vision, there has to be, it has to be equitable between counties and cities, and not to have to have counties ask permission to get back what their urban growth area boundary was. That's a primary concern I have with this whole thing. So I don't know where that will be addressed.
that is a change, not a wholesale throwing out. But it is something. I think the other thing I would say is I think this is way too long. I mean, for you to comprehend, it sort of repeats the same thing over and over again. I mean, we can't even get it all on the same screen up here. I would suggest that we kind of take a minute and condense this if we're going to keep it. But I would ask for in the future, if this is going to stay, it needs to be revised because it does not work for counties that have rural areas.
Yeah, I just wanted to speak to Commissioner Sharp's point that, in fact, I'm sure many of you remember Commissioner Rod Bockenfeld here in May, maybe? I think the May meeting, maybe? Where he talked about this flaw and this situation that the counties had where the assumption in current policy is that if there is no agreement between the city and the county and during annexation, that the that if it's currently covered by UGBA by the county and the annexation occurs, that that follows the city. And that was a point that Commissioner Bockenfeld made, and certainly a note that we took, that when the board starts talking about or reopening and reexamining how UGBA works and what the policies are surrounding it, et cetera, that was something that needed to be addressed at that time. So that's the plan right now. That's not to say that you can't do something here today. I just want to let you know, though, what the plan was based on the discussion we had back in May.
So I'm going to ask, I see a number of placards that are down. So evidently there's a number of people who still wish to have some discussion or have comments. So if your placard's not facing up, I'm assuming you've got something you still want to add. So, Mr. Teal.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Okay, so it's really a question. And I mean, I'm just getting the feeling, do we need to have a section in here? Obviously, as Nancy pointed out, this is a hugely long narrative here. Do we need to have another section where we talk about the ability of counties, the ability of member communities to increase and add to their UGA as market conditions and demographics shift? I'm throwing that out there. If nobody picks it up, then it doesn't get picked up.
Ms. Millay?
I just have another. I'm kind of in line with what Nancy said. It seems odd to me that we're identifying all the good things that are going to be coming from this outcome within the narrative of the outcome. And going back to just a simpler, cleaner definition, not that I'm disagreeing with that it will promote more efficient resource allocation for infrastructure and it will reduce vehicle travel and achieve greater density and all of those other things. I'm not quite sure why we need to put them. All the good things, we're not listing all the good things that are going to happen from the diverse, whatever that first one we called, diverse livable communities. We didn't say everything wonderful that's going to happen because of that. So I'm wondering why we find the need to do it here. Why don't we just say, a defined UGB/A promotes an orderly, compact, and efficient pattern of future development within the region. And then we skip down to a limited amount of semi-urban or rural development will continue to occur. And when we list our objectives and move across is where we kind of get a little bit more specific about all the good things that will happen. I'm just wondering why we find the need to identify them here.
Jerry, you have a comment.
Yeah, I was just going to touch on that one for you, Jackie. As I read some of that information, and I don't disagree with your comment, what you have is you have the effect, right? That's mm-hmm. what you're seeing, right? Now, whether it's in that narrative or not probably is a debatable, certainly. What that effect does helps you identify particular measures. I mean, when you look at effect and all the things that will happen as a result of this work or the outcome, it will help you identify certain metrics, but you may already have them already. I don't know, I can't make the relationship one-to-one, but sometimes, you know, that additional outcome stuff just helps you do that.
Well, and if I could just respond, and I know we're not supposed to read ahead, But
well, don't
you did anyway.
But no, but our objectives say direct growth to areas with infrastructure and services. I mean, we are doing it. I'm not sure why we need to be so repetitive here to Commissioner Sharp's point.
Yeah, all I'm saying is just helps you identify somewhere you'll want to identify those effects that will help you design. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah, that you'll design the measures around. Okay.
Mr. Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What Jerry was just saying really resonates with me. I do agree that this should be substantially shorter. It's not concise, and I think that could create problems. But I would actually edit out different text. So, in fact, I think we can just eliminate everything from a limited amount of semi-urban through the end of that paragraph and keep the previous information that was redlined. I do think that we need some kind of qualifying or particular language. And there's also a lot of confusion around this issue, I think, for members. And so that's my suggestion. I do appreciate the brevity. I think it's very important to make it more concise. But I'm kind of partial to the language that's currently redlined. I would prefer that we strike the remaining part of the paragraph.
Brad, you got it? Figured out?
Mm-hmm. All right, so we can arm wrestle over that if you're interested.
Yeah, let's give him a second left to get the changes made up so everyone can see them.
And please correct me if I do something wrong. Okay.
Will promote rather than will prevent.
And Robin, will you just repeat it to me again?
The prevent unnecessary
use. Efficient resource allocation for
caught up now with the changes been proposed so far. George, I'll come back to you in a second. I got you. Okay, Roger, I'm back to you.
Okay.
At least you're up next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to verify what I was kind of asking before, and I think it's prudent for all of us to know again regarding the UBGA, when it was the last time that each of the 57 members had verified their UBGA, and if they had, because I think it's a very important thing. I'll give an example. We have two new members in the last so many years, so that's a majority of our board, and I think it's just prudent that we see that. So when the last time verified, because it's not certainly I don't disagree with the UGBA. I think the narrative is very good, but I think we really need to know that to be fully and honest to our boards who we represent.
All right, so I'm going to try to get your answer first. Brad, can you?
Sure, general time frame. So traditionally the way this has been done is that the request for additional UGB or UGA happens in advance of the Metro Vision planning process, right? So that last call for additional UGB, UGA would have been 2009 time frame in advance of Metro Vision 2035 that was adopted in 2011. But I think the one thing that I would add that's important, and I can't remember who said it, but that I thought was good, is this is sort of the outcome thing that says this is important to us. UGB is hard because it's both the sort of desired outcome and it's a tool, right? And that's where it gets really tricky for folks. It gets hard for us to even sort of sort those things out. So this really says it's important to us, but we know there's a lot of work to do on the tool itself and how that process actually works. And I promise you the first thing that this group will do, whether you like it or not, after Metro Vision is adopted, is to pick those rules up and make sure they meet the needs of our members. I mean, that's the first thing out of the gate.
I think it's interesting, Brad, it is very important, and I think it's interesting to see if anybody in the room was actually instrumental in that UBGA. So I guess I think that's a very important thing to each one of our communities that we have this clarified. So I'd like to see that actually, if you can give it each jurisdiction when they did, because I believe there's probably your jurisdictions that have not. I think it's a very important thing because then we're asking somebody to vote on something that would say, wait, we haven't taken a position on it. We haven't provided that. I think that's due diligence of the staff.
And just the other thing that I would add is we always talk about Metro Vision being dynamic. If a community wants to make an adjustment to their existing UGB UGA, they can do it during any of those sort of regular plan cycle amendments. I mean, there are obviously things that go along with that, but that is really what that's for, is so that people can tell us that they have more recent information that they want to share with folks.
Again, I'm going to request that staff pursue this and ask the jurisdictions, instead of expecting the jurisdiction to just provide it to you. Because again, I'll tell you, 2.5 years, I haven't seen it.
Oh, I'll add one more thing. We actually have a survey that's live right now that has gone to every planning director in the region that is asking pretty much that exact question. Is how much do you know about UGB, UGA? When was the last time that you have done a thoughtful review of your current UGB, UGA situation? You know, who does it? Is it the planning staff at the GIS? We are trying to gather that intelligence to really inform the board conversation that will happen in the future.
Which brings up my point. That's why I think we're having a hard time looking at this right now.
Let me go on, Elise. I got you. Ms. Sharp.
I want to support Anthony's comment. I think it is important having a sentence explaining why UGBA is useful and how it provides benefits to the region that helps support the other outcomes that we haven't gotten to yet. I was going to make this the further suggestion, just to combine all the goodness in a single sentence. You could just put a comma, get rid of the "in addition, it will," and just finish it. So you just have one explanatory sentence saying, you know, these are the benefits that derive from developing within the UGBA. And that would give us a two-sentence narrative, which I think is pretty brief.
Can you get one more time for me?
Just get rid of the period, "in addition, it will," and put a comma there, and then you're just...
We'll
promote efficient research.
Oh, I got you.
Comma.
I just said get rid of, keep the will. Will reduce regional bill. Will help. You see what I'm saying? So put.
Oh, there we go. I was like, oh.
Comma.
Put a comma. Get rid of that period. And in addition, it.
And even the will. All the way through the will.
Yep. Keep deleting.
Delete that.
Okay.
Delete up to reduce.
Is that right?
Yep.
Okay.
Hey.
Sorry.
Yeah. So it'll promote this, it'll reduce that, it'll help cheap, conserve. So just two sentences, short and to the point.
All right. Next one I have, Mr. Teal again, please.
So this is really cool, but I actually want to support going back to Jackie's edit. I mean, I think this is great and all, but guys, if we, and yes, I have committed the sin of reading ahead here, but if we look at what we've talked about having as targets for this outcome, there's only one target, guys, 25% increase of urban growth between 2014 and 2040. So this is great, all this additional information, but per our coaching from Jerry, it does not inform us to what we want that target to be. Therefore, yeah, I want to go back to what Jackie had. I think it slims it down, it focuses it, and it provides what we need in order to come around to the target, which we've already said we like, we're probably going to stick with.
Next one I have is Commissioner Sharp, then Commissioner Rozier, then Mr. Graves.
Trying to figure out where this could go. There is one part, a few words in here that I really like, and that were deleted, and that is locally adopted policies and market demand, because I think that is so. I'm trying to figure out, defined UGBA promotes an orderly, compact, efficient pattern of future development within the region in response to locally adopted policies and market demand. Would that be acceptable to put that? Because I think it is market demand. I mean, we're not building stuff. It's a market demand. In the first sentence, at the end of the first sentence.
Above that one.
Yeah, at the end, it says within the region, say in response to, or something, I'm not sure if that reads very well, in response to adopted policies and locally adopted policies and market demand.
Sorry, I'm trying to catch up from the first one.
Within the region.
Yep.
If you go up to the end of the first sentence.
Region being the last.
Yep. And then if you say in response to locally adopted policies and market demands. Does that read, I need for everybody to read that, see if that makes sense. But I do like that because it ensures that we have local control in some way, and also that there are market demands that are going to be building one way or the other.
Hang on, Jerry. Commissioner Rozier?
That happened to me.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I will, I agree with George in going back with Jackie's original comments. I do like what Commissioner Sharp has added here. However, I want to just point out down below the last sentence where it says outside the boundary and maintain separation between communities. There are many urban communities that have zero separation, so we're not maintaining a separation. And in many cases, separations, if we're talking about efficiencies of infrastructure, we're talking about efficiencies of roadways, why would we want to have this separation between communities? So once again, we're arguing against ourselves when we talk about separation, because now we're creating islands, and we were talking about efficiencies up above. So would you not want to have communities together?
Mr. Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner Rozier, I actually agree with you on this last point. Bob is like, what's going on over here? So, Commissioner Rozier, as I was saying, I do think that there's a lot of work that can be done in terms of greater integration of infrastructure and the way that we seamlessly come together as communities. So I don't have a bone to pick with that recommendation. Commissioner Sharp, I'm very comfortable with this in response to locally adopted policies and market demand. But I would like to keep the remaining language as discussed, including this reduced regional vehicle travel, help achieve greater density, and conserve open land outside the boundary area. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I want to ask if this is actually reflective now of where the team is, because we might have consensus on this issue to move on. Yes or no?
We do not have consensus.
We do not.
So what something's coming back now is my understanding. What is there something coming back, or is that?
And I'm glad it's got the computer, not Jerry.
Yeah, just a comment. I know it's easy to sin, like reading forward. What the problem with that is, though, if we base what we're doing now on the current stuff we have beyond this outcome, that's likely to change. You see, so what I would do is really, if you can just focus in on these outcomes and narratives, we will square away that objective. And once we square away those objectives, we'll square away those measures, I promise. But if we take a very disciplined, kind of discrete approach, I think you'll find it'll move better. But it is kind of confusing to look ahead at certain metrics that may not really play into this outcome yet. And if we do it in sequence, I think you'll find it works pretty well. And I think you'll find it validates some of the ones you've already decided you'd like to keep.
So
just suggestion.
Here's a suggestion for you. There is not agreement on this one. There's a very wide discussion going on. There is nowhere near a consensus. We are still on the second one. We have 45 minutes left. Can we agree to table this one, think about it, and try to get to another one, understanding that this is not done? If you are in agreement with that, put your placards up, and we'll try to table this one for the time being, and we'll move to number three and see if we can make any headway. Otherwise, we stay here on number two. I believe we have a consensus that we will move to number three, and we will table number two for the time being. Jerry, let's go.
Note to self. Okay, Brad's got it. Vibrant and connected urban centers and multimodal corridors accommodate a growing share of the region's housing and employment needs. Lots of stuff in that one. Go ahead and just study. Is the outcome viable? And then we'll review any edits to the outcome itself or the and or the narrative.
Mr. Rozier, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. With the outcome itself, if you look at multimodal corridors, I know this goes back 6-9 months talking about corridors. We had strategic corridors, and that definition was struck in the past. I don't believe we have a clear definition of what a multimodal corridor is. Do we?
No, we do not.
So in this decision here, or discussion as far as outcome three, it's very confusing. In essence, my definition is different than somebody else's. So I would look to revise that language, just to say vibrant and connected urban centers with corridors that accommodate a growing share of the region's housing, you know, so on. If we put multimodal corridors in there, but still at the same time do we need to define what a corridor is? That's up for the discussion of the group. Thank you.
Ms. Noon.
So if we take it out of the top, it's in the bottom, and it's not highlighted in red. So have we been using multimodal corridors in the last version?
Yes.
Without a definition.
Drawing them on a map, right? It's just sort of a concept more so than urban centers are designated, right? They are things right. Designated in the plan. We have not designated corridors.
We haven't designated them nor really defined
correct.
Them. Okay. Just wanted to make sure where we were before.
All right. On outcome three, are there any other comments? Mr. Plass, I have you, Mr. Graves, Ms. Sharp.
Yeah, I have a concern about removing multimodal. As a vision for where we want to be, I think it should include multimodal. It's not, for me, it's not just about corridors, but having that kind of complete street idea, I think, is very important as we move forward.
Okay, Mr. Graves.
I think this goes back to this earlier discussion that we were having with Councilman Teal when we were using the word multimodal. I think to strike it entirely changes. Okay, I'm back. I think to strike it entirely changes the sort of meaning and tone of this. Perhaps there's alternative language, but to strike it entirely I'm opposed to as well.
Hey, I've got you again, Don. Commissioner Sharp, I think I saw yours.
If this document is to, not to say that we wouldn't be, but the first sentence is sort of time sensitive. Denver region has been recognized as, we hope we will be always recognized for good things, but I don't think that belongs in a document like this. So I would remove that and really talk about the outcome. Trying to simplify, get rid of some of the words here. I think it's too lengthy. I think on all these you have to kind of be concise. So maybe there's, and it's hard for me to do this all on the fly here, but while the location and context of each center and corridor will help define its unique character and they share a common set of characteristics, are we defining this in here, what an urban center, we're providing the definition for what an urban center is that the purpose? Because it seems like that's what we're doing here is they are transit, pedestrian, bicycle friendly. So is that, I'm just thinking back to what was said here, that it's supposed to be value-based and aspirational. I'm not sure that is as aspirational for the long term, for the longevity of a document. So I can keep trying to do this, but it's really hard to wordsmith the link that's on. Maybe somebody else can help here with how we make this more concise and focus on, to me, it's accommodate a growing share of region's housing and employment needs. But then there's all this other stuff in here that I don't think really, we've already said vibrant, connected urban centers.
Yeah.
So Ms. Sharp, can I ask you, can you take a second look at it? Let me catch one more and I'll come back to you. Roger, you had one.
No. I think we might be missing something if we just focus on urban centers. Urban centers connect each other through suburban area. Also, I think we put in there vibrant and connected urban and suburban centers, or urban center and suburban areas. And I think we're missing something there. I think we're limiting where a lot of the employment, well, I guarantee you, there's been a lot of employment in our county and in suburban area. And now we've got a need to connect that, because how do we get people the jobs to support our economy? We connect them.
Mr. Rozier, folks, I've got some of these hands, but I'm going to go down the list I've got. I got Rozier, Kanish, Jones, Sharp, and Piper.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I agree with Commissioner Partridge's comments, but I also want to go back to the discussion of we had talked about that multimodal in the corridor. With that, you know, if it's included, then we need to define it. And if the definition is, you know, complete streets, I would really have a problem with that. We have urban centers in our mountain communities that are not connected by urban streets, nor do they want to be connected by complete streets. They do not want sidewalks. And in these areas, so once again, that comes down to what is the definition of multimodal, and how we define that and in there. So if we do not have that defined, if we just say corridors, that is a local control issue, and that is a local determination of how that corridor is handled. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Ms. Kanish.
Once again, I'm going to try to offer some language to help be responsive to Nancy's questions and concerns. So I wonder if we can go in that first sentence with something shorter that has something like, the Denver region can build on its success, its successful, you know, track record of urban centers and multimodal corridors, right? So the idea is kind of to get to your point about it's not about external recognition, it's just acknowledging there's been success. I mean, we invested in fast tracks and we've seen economic return on that as a region. So that's kind of the idea I'm trying to tap into. Shorter and more timeless is my goal. So trying to be responsive.
All right, so before we move on, Robin, let me make sure that the changes that we just highlighted is what you were saying.
Well, delete this and keep your suggestion.
Yeah, maybe can build on the successful outcomes achieved through its emphasis on urban centers and multimodal corridors. And then I would not support the change of suburban in the top. And it's not actually because I disagree with your point at all about suburban. It's just that we use that term urban center, and it includes five different subtypes. So we can say urban center, and everywhere else in our plans, it references those subtypes. It's a term of art. Urban center is for the region. We have a suburban town center. We have a rural town center. All of those are included. So this is kind of similar to Jackie's changes in the previous one, right? When you have a term that encompasses all of the other terms already, I just think that it's okay to use the term of art, because this is well defined elsewhere, that there are subtypes. And in fact, it's also defined down below, as well as in the prior. If you remember, our prior two themes actually speak to this diversity as well. So I totally agree that you want to be inclusive of those. I'm just saying in this case that term throughout our thing has subtypes in it. So
Ms. Jones, you're up.
Thanks. I would support that, Robin. I would make the same I think in general we should figure out if we agree on the outcome and then edit the narrative. That might make us move through this faster. So I would suggest going back to the original outcome. I think, you know, Commissioner Rozier makes a point, maybe if we need to define multimodal corridors, then maybe we should somewhere in the document. But I'm thinking of it more as a lowercase multimodal corridors, the concept of connections between urban centers that have different transportation options. So that concept, though, I think is integral to Metro Vision. So I would support going back to the original outcome. And then I would make a suggestion to the chair. This group, if we're going to wordsmith at this level, every narrative, what we may want to do is tell staff, we only want three sentences of narrative description, and it should describe this, list some benefits, period, and have staff go back and rewrite if this is what we're going to do. If this is our goal is to make this shorter, and then we wouldn't have to go through this, I think it might be faster. So this body may want to decide its global intention around brevity, and then let staff take a stab at it.
I'd take that on. I would do it.
Hang on just a second. Let me. I'm trying to catch a quick list of names. All right. Here's who I've got so far that still want to talk, and we're moving into 30 minutes left. I've got Commissioner Sharp, Mr. Teal, Vigil, Quinn, Jerry. You wanted to talk, and Ms. Malay. And the suggestion is that we're going to sit here, folks, for the next several months, wordsmithing these things to the point that we have done tonight. We've spent almost 2 hours. We haven't been able to finish but one. And I'm not sure there's full agreement even on the one. So we can keep doing this. I have no problem finishing this list. Add to it whatever you want. But in 30 minutes, we quit for tonight. And then we'll take it back up again. I like the suggestion that was made that staff go back and make these darn things shorter, which Jerry's nodding his head up and down that he's willing to do that, and then bring it back to us. If not, we'll stay here. And I certainly don't have any problem ordering dinner, if that's what you want. No, we'll bill it to Jerry, because he wrote the document to start with. So before I go back down this list and we start through all these comments again, do we have a consensus that we want the staff to go back and take another shot at this in a shorter, more concise version, or do we want to continue this as it is now? Let me have some kind of an idea. Ms. Malay?
I actually think it's worthwhile for us to spend the time discussing the outcomes, but I completely agree with Elise that the narrative then could be rewritten by staff once we've got agreement on the outcomes. So if that's what we're deciding with our little yellow cards.
That's not what you're deciding with your yellow cards. You're like right now you're deciding if you want to continue down this continued discussion and this wordsmithing to the level we're doing, or do you want to give staff an opportunity to go back before we continue this wordsmithing.
Right, but we,
if you want,
so Herb, let me just ask it a different way. I do not want to wordsmith the narratives. I do think we're doing a little more than wordsmithing when we're discussing the outcomes. I do think this body should attempt to go through and discuss the way we want the outcome written, and then I'm perfectly fine. And that, I think, is what Elise suggested, so I'm all in for that. But I just want to clarify that that is what we're doing. We're still going to be discussing the outcomes, just not the outcome narrative.
Let me restate the objective. If you want to deal with only the outcomes for the remainder of the time we have tonight and leave the narratives alone and let staff go back to the and try to do a narrative once we have an outcome. They can't redo the narrative if we don't have an outcome. We can stay here and start working on the outcomes and leave the narratives alone. That's going to take a lot of effort by everybody to leave them alone. So if you would like to proceed on with working only on the outcomes, leave all the narratives alone until we have an agreed upon outcome, put your little flags up, and we'll try to do that. And we'll start with the one we're on. Okay, we do not have a total agreement. Thank you, Roger. Right now I have... I have a supermajority of dealing only with the outcomes. Yes. We have consensus. All right, put them down so we know where we're going next time.
Yes.
K, Can we deal only with the number three for right now? Let's try to finish that one, then we'll go back and see if we can grab anything else. Any other comments, or I can start again with the list where I left off. Ms. Sharp, you're up next if you want to deal only with the outcome. If you want to go to the narrative, I'm going to skip you for the time being.
Skip me.
Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Teal, outcome only.
Outcome only. Can I refer to the narrative?
No.
So here's the deal. I'm going to anyhow. Here's the problem. Guys, look at that narrative. When you read that narrative about an urban center, that is the Castle Rock Urban Center. Any of you who have not been to our downtown, please come. You can go have a couple beers at Maddie's Beer Garden and stumble your way multimodally back to your parking spot. But here's the problem that we're not addressing, and I would like us to address, by placing transportation in front of the word corridors. In outcome one, guys, we said that we would go ahead and say transportation to mean, understanding that meant multimodal. So when I say let's put transportation in front of corridors, guys, that once again brings Castle Rock into the brotherhood of friends here in DRCOG, because, guys, I don't have a multimodal way to get to the next urban center, but I have an urban center that is multimodal.
You don't have a designated urban center.
Yes, we do. Downtown Castle Rock is a designated urban center.
Don't give it on the list.
Well, then somebody better put it on the list.
Okay, so that one has made the list.
Correct. So, yeah, so we have it, guys. What we don't have, and this is straight from my staff comments, we need that word transportation there in front of corridors, because we're talking about, we like being multimodal in our urban center. We're supportive of that language. We're supportive of outcomes that give us that. But, guys, we need a transportation corridor that allows us to connect our vibrant and connected urban center to anybody else's.
Okay, next person up, Mr. V. Hill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I agree with you. I think that we need, if we're going to go through using the term transportation as opposed to multimodal, then we need to stay with it. And I also agree with Kanish that and suburban areas need to be deleted, because I mean that's you know part of the urban center already. I mean you just can't start itemizing all of the sub urban centers that we have out there, because I mean that's just a given.
Mr. Quinn.
Thank you. I think we should remove suburban areas. I still think we ought to leave the word multimodal in there. And multimodal doesn't necessarily mean a complete street. Complete street really refers more to an urban environment looking at the pedestrian and having full access. And it would mean a different, it doesn't mean the same thing in all areas. So I'm fine with the word transportation, multimodal transportation corridors. So I'm fine having that word in there as well.
All right, so hang on. Go ahead, Brad. Let's see if we can get everything caught back in there again.
And I'm just keeping it highlighted because obviously there's a lot sort of going on with these five or six words, so that's what the highlight means.
All right, Jerry. You had a comment you wanted to make, or are you passing?
No, you had it.
Okay. Ms. Millay, you're up now.
Okay, I actually would like to rewrite outcome three to say, accommodate a growing share of the region's housing and employment in connected urban centers. I'm not sure why we need the multimodal corridors. I don't know what that means, but if we're in a connected urban just look at the words before you react to them, please. Accommodate a growing share of the region's housing and employment in connected urban centers.
Not vibrant.
Oh, vibrant is ridiculous. I mean, that's such a qualifying word. What does that mean?
It's aspirational.
Oh, give me a break.
Okay, we've got your comments in.
That's it.
Ms. Jones?
So I guess I want to put in a plug. It's ironic to me that this body is arguing against multimodal transportation after our preoccupation with the TIP recently. But the point is, by 2040, do we want our urban centers to be connected by multimodal transportation corridors? And I think the answer is yes. Multimodal means more than one mode. Doesn't specify which, doesn't mandate transit. This is our aspirational vision for the region as a whole. It's not mandating anything for each community. Aspirational vision in 2040, several decades from now. So we do want our regions to be, or our urban centers to be multimodal internally, and we want them to connect to each other. So I think we need to add back multimodal transportation, because that's a key piece of this.
If I could just respond.
Just
I guess, to me, connected urban centers, again, it can be multimodal, and sometimes they will be multimodal, and sometimes they won't. I don't understand why connected doesn't suffice. And to me, it isn't, because frankly, Castle Rock's urban center and Lone Tree's urban center are never going to be connected multimodally. They're just not. But they will be connected to each other. But I would argue Lone Tree's urban center and Denver's urban center may have multimodal connections. So it is, to me, connected embraces all of it. It doesn't exclude.
Mr. Pfeiffer, then Mr. Graves.
Well, I would say you are going to be connected multimodal, because one day a train will connect the two. Mm-mm. It could, yes. We're talking. It could. Mm-mm. It could.
Never. Not going to happen.
But there, well, maybe not. But again,
That hovercraft. I'm going to get on that hoverboard.
Well, hey, wait. We haven't got to Phil's jetpacks yet, and we're going to get to those later. But
Texas has a hoverboard.
But 2040. Remember 2040. I see buses. You're going to have buses. You're going to have the cars. You're going to have the trains. There's going to be other things.
We're going to be connected.
Hopefully, but why can't we put multimodal? That's more than one mode of connecting. A bus and a car, to me, are two different modes. That's multimodal. If it was one car and that's all we did all day long, then I can see us doing maybe mono modal. That's a new word, right? I'm struggling with us sitting on this multimodal. All it's just saying is, let's just try to find more than one way to get somewhere and keep it that simple.
Mr. Graves, then Ms. Stoltzman, and then Jerry.
Thank you, Mr.
And I've got you back again, Roger.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, I've tried to be very flexible on this issue, trying to be sensitive to the needs of various communities across the metro area, because we really are in this together. But the longer I reflect upon this, and as this conversation evolves, I feel like we're really beginning to diminish here what we should not. Everyone, frankly, is already multimodal. I've been going on district tours with nearly every member of the RTD board, and whether it's Lone Tree or other places, there are people who are carpooling or sending their kids together in vans to various sporting events, right, with parents, and there are folks who are biking in various parts of communities. Trains may not come to different pieces, right? Buses are happening. So multimodal is already happening in our various communities, and so to completely shut the door on it, I think we're really refuting the obvious. And I think as well that we're sort of beginning to work against one of the purposes of this organization, which is sort of to connect and look at transportation infrastructure in multiple ways that it's defined.
Ms. Stoltzman, if you would, please.
Thank you. Yeah, I think we already are connected multimodally. For me to get from my urban center in Louisville to your urban center in Castle Rock, I could take a variety of transit options. I could take a bus to a light rail and then rent a car and come the rest of the way. So I see quite a lot of connections already there. I don't really see the reason to take it out. I can walk there. I can bike the whole way. I mean, there are a lot of ways today, and I don't think it's that aspirational to put multimodal in. I think it already exists. I think there's this idea that means that the light rail will have to run all the way from Louisville to Castle Rock by 2040, and I don't necessarily think that's the answer. I mean, hopefully Elon Musk is listening to this, and he's going to put tubes everywhere for us. So, I mean, there's just a lot that could happen, and I don't see the concern with the word multimodal staying in.
What's your edit then?
Jerry.
My only comment is we've spent a lot of time on that one term, and usually that's because we don't have a common agreement of what that term means. Does that sound familiar? So there's only two choices, is to define that term or get rid of it. There's only two choices. So, I mean, we probably should scope it out or make a decision on it. What's that? I'm sorry? Yeah, I mean, there are a lot of words in here that really do need some explicit definition. It's just the way outcomes need to be written. And there's still some, we use the term weasel words, which is not because, well, anyway, it's an empty kind of thing. So there's certain terms in there you won't be able to measure and understand. And if you've got some disagreement on one, the best thing to do is to get some agreement on what that term means.
Okay, this is who I have on the list waiting to talk. Ms. Sharp, Mr. Vigil, Mr. Cernanik, Mr. Partridge, and Ms. Kniefs. That's the ones I have on the list right now.
I'm going to be brief. I agree. I think probably some of the concern is that if it's not defined, it will be a weasel word, and it will be used to, it can be used to have a community, to use against a community in a certain way. So I think it needs to be defined before it's in there because it's causing a lot of consternation. And I think it's not, we're going to continue on this path. I don't have any problem with connected urban centers, but if we're not going to go that way, clear definition, because that's the only way to not have this be used. But you said that this was going to be, and you have this in your document, and you agreed to it 3 or 4 years from now, and you say, well, what does that mean? Been there, done that. I think we have to be very careful with some of the words that are giving a lot of heartburn to people in this room.
Okay. Mr. Vigil?
Thanks, Mr. Chair. And I think two things. Number one is that let's stay focused. This is a vision. This is what we envision for 2040. And so if we don't look to the future as to what might not happen and narrow ourselves, you know, then we're not going to succeed. We're not going to go anywhere. So let's keep in mind on that. The other issue I was just going to make as a FYI, I travel a lot south to the San Luis Valley, and I remember when it would take me 45 minutes from the end of Denver to Castle Rock. Now from the Cabela's at Lone Tree, I make it in 7 minutes. That's how much we're connecting, and we will be connected one way or the other.
Mr. Cernanik.
Yes, I was just going through my notes that I had previously on at least the three outcomes we've talked about. The first one is livables in the eye of the beholder and not one size fits all. Second is sprawl is bad to the extent we can encourage diversity, density, it's good. In this one, when we get to this, it's folks are well connected between where they live and where they work.
Mr. Partridge.
Mr. Chair, my comments are going to be, I'll lobby again for suburban. So if we're on the conversation of multimodal and transportation, I'll just say I'll wait.
Okay. Ms. Kanish.
Thanks. I chimed in because I hear where you're coming from, Jerry, that sometimes you have confusion about definition, but I actually don't think that's the case here. I think that there are sometimes value differences. So I don't want to take us down the rabbit hole, because and there may be two different value differences. And I'm not assuming which this is, but there's one value difference, which is that someone likes multimodal and someone doesn't. Those are value differences. They aren't differences of definition. Another difference, which I'm hoping actually this may be, is that we have different value differences about the impact of this document or this language, right? Which is that if I could wave a magic wand and get more buses to my community, I would do that. I'm just nervous about what happens if I can't, right? So that's a value difference about the impact of the document, not about whether I like the opportunity to get bike trails or buses, right? So I wonder if to take this a different direction, to kind of get out of the idea of connecting, I actually always read this one a little differently than this discussion has reflected, to be either in urban centers or in multimodal corridors. Those are the two places that you want the growth happening. It wasn't so much that every connection between urban centers was multimodal. And so
I guess I'm just wondering if adding an or is helpful. Vibrant and connected urban centers or multimodal, you know, so I'm actually fine with Jackie's rephrasing. So if you want to do, I will try it this way. So go down to Jackie's language. Accommodate a growing share of the region's housing and employment in connected urban centers or multimodal corridors. It creates a broader range of places. And I actually think that's the way we've often talked about it. If you think about it, we often will, you know, you may not have every place along a transit line as a urban center, but we talk elsewhere about putting growth near the transit line, right? So it's kind of a way to basically, it creates an or rather than an and. And again, I think, you were gone for a second, George, but I was just saying that I think that I don't hear the folks necessarily who are sharing concerns. I don't think you hate buses or bikes or walking. I just think you're concerned about what the implications of the document are. And I think the time to debate that's later. I think it's in those later columns that we're not looking at. Because I don't think if I said we have $20 million for bike and trail improvements, I don't think there's probably a community in here who wouldn't want some of that. Or like Castle Rock, you fought for more bus service from RTD. You would like to see that, right? Like, so I don't think you're saying you don't want it. I just think you're concerned about the implications, perhaps. So that's my hope, that I don't want us going down the rabbit hole of definition. I think it glosses over what I think are value differences. And I want to confront those and see if we can shift them a little bit, you know, and maybe find a way forward. So that's my hope.
All right, where you stand right now, I only see two people who said they've had enough. Kathy, go ahead.
I just want a clarification. Am I only doing accommodate and below? The top part is gone, right? Not that it has, but we're only going with the red words starting with accommodate.
That was the most recent suggestion.
Want to be clear.
Jerry? All right, so where we're at right now, just to clarify and make sure, in the outcome for number three, the last sentence starts with the word accommodate a growing share. That is the version that exists at this moment.
That's where it begins?
Yeah. So that's where it begins.
Delete the rest.
Okay, you're good? All right.
Okay. There. So the one unmarked through sentence is the only part of this outcome. And at least the major portion, I still see several people who are not ready to quit talking about it. Mayor Rakowski, would you like to comment? Evan?
Okay,
Atchison doesn't have a thing to say because he's jeering this right now. And Ron's using two votes for one. Commissioner Rozier, do you have any other comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would respectfully disagree with Robin that if you put something down where there's been discussion tonight of what really truly defines multimodal, and we have 40 different definitions, then why put it, Robin? If you just put corridors, corridors are corridors. So once again, multimodal is different to me, it's different to you, it's different to everybody else. And if it's going to cause confusion tonight, it's going to cause confusion 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 20 years from now. So define it or don't use it.
Hey. Just a second. I'm coming back to you because yours is still laid down.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I guess I'm a little frustrated right now. And I'd like to express, how did we go from the wish of the representative Denver being our course of action, a wish, that you called it, Robin, you called it a wish, and you put it out there that as a maybe. How do we go to that as our actual course of action when we've had other opinions expressed before then? Well, you know, Jackie's was a sub-segment off to the side of maybe we're going to do it, maybe we're not, and then Robin makes a wish, and all of a sudden it's done. What about all of us who in that case, I wish that no. I don't like what we have going right now. I would like to strike out accommodate two corridors, and I would like us to go back to vibrant and connected urban centers and multimodal corridors, transportation corridors, that accommodate a growing share of the region's housing and employment needs. I actually got to enjoy that. I got to like that. That was okay by me. So I think I would like to see the, you know, the discussion continue, because I guess I had a wish there too.
Okay, Mr. Partridge, I'll come to you, Mr. Mitchell.
First.
He's added back in a portion that was.
Well, again, I was expressing my frustration on the fact that we started with the conversation, and yes, I know I stepped out in the middle of it, of talking about getting a good definition of multimodal and how we probably can't continue without a good definition of multimodal. And that's where Robin picked it up, and Robin went and said these are value statements and we probably shouldn't get it bogged down. And then she added on as the end, and I have a wish that to set to accommodate a growing share of region's housing and employment. And all of a sudden, that became the course of action. So I would say, I guess I'm a little concerned about the methodology we're following, Nancy, because the representative of Denver has a wish, and suddenly that becomes a command. The rest of us have to nug through all the details, it seems.
All right, hang on, guys. Look, let's keep this on a professional basis, and let's not get into this. I'm trying to accommodate those who have not put their placards up that they're ready to do this. I want to make sure we get their comments in, especially anybody who hasn't commented recently. So right now what I have left that still has said they are not in a consensus, Mr. Teal has just finished his, Commissioner Rozier finished his, I've got Mr. Partridge and Ms. Jones and then Ms. Sharp that we're still trying to get comments. Ms. Sharp, you're done. Thank you very much. Mr. Partridge, then I'm going to Mr. Jones, and after that, folks, we're probably adjourning.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just comment on multimodal. I agree with Commissioner Rozier. I think if we, you know, maybe that's something I can agree on if it's left in there with the idea that we're going to have a definition come forward. That's my comment on multimodal. I'm going to lobby again for something regarding that suburban area, and I'm almost thinking that maybe we just ought to use the term the urban growth boundary. Because I'm going to look at urban centers, I'm going to look at Douglas County and look at Castle Rock Parker and Lone Tree. When we look at saying growing share of the region's housing and employment, I think we're pretty limited on the urban centers of those areas. And I'm going to say the local zoning codes right now very limited on height requirements. I'm one of those, I think maybe there's the idea that we increase those height requirements would help that, but right now those local codes aren't there. And I think it really limits it in our county when we especially tie connecting these and talk about employment housing. I'm going to say maybe we just say vibrant connected urban growth boundary area.
Ms. Jones.
2 points. One is in this particular case, I think multimodal is very simply defined. It's more than one mode, right? Any definition in any dictionary, I just looked up, there were six, just more than one mode. So in this particular case, I don't think we need, and we should maybe write that down so everybody's, but I think it's a pretty simple definition, and I think most of us would agree on that, right? Just more than one mode. It's nothing more complicated than that. And I guess I want to suggest for this process, because we've had a very robust discussion, and we were about 98% there, that maybe we should straw poll. It would be ideal if we had 100% agreement on this, but that might be a lot to ask. So if we have 95, 98%, maybe we could go with something. So I guess I would like to end on a positive note. I would like to go back to the Jackie proposal as augmented by Robin and see, just straw poll it and see if we're pretty close. With the understanding that when we say multimodal, we mean more than one mode.
Ms. Sharp, go ahead. I still have your list.
You know, I think it needs to be defined because we're going to use it throughout the document, I think, and I think it's best. There's no reason why we shouldn't have a definition that people are comfortable. I mean, I think we're not, there's no reason to shy away. There are probably going to be lots of things in here that are going to need some definition. This seems to be one of them. Let's do it. Ask staff to put together a definition.
Let me ask you this. is there any discourse that multimodal means simply more than one mode? It's, we can define it just that simple. Multimodal means more than one mode. End of comment. Is everybody okay with that?
So that's our definition.
Yeah. That's what we will put in the document.
All right. That'll be in the narrative.
Okay. Does that satisfy everyone? Please see thumbs up or hands down or heads up, something. Okay. Good. You have a definition. Now, with that definition, are we any closer to an acceptable outcome three? I see a lot of pages still up. Any of those? I have another one came up. I have two. I have one that I can see. I'm down that far that I've got two placards still turned down that they want to continue discussion. Then I'm going to...
I'm okay with ending discussion, but I'll stand on urban growth area, suburban area, because I think there's more to it. But I'm for ending discussion.
Okay. For the time being...
Yeah, to that point...
No, hang on.
Oh.
We're ending it.
Yeah, we are, but I have a question.
I'll get your question in just a minute. But right now we're ending with the definition of multimodal that we just described. We had no objection to it. We are going to leave the outcome three as it is currently highlighted. And other than that, the effort for tonight is tabled. We are not done. We did not finish number two, and we have only 13 more to do. Jackie,
I'm just wondering if staff could actually come back with definition for the urban centers. I mean, some of these words that, in your judgment, that you staff think you've heard us question, and what does that exactly mean? If you could come up with those definitions for us, I think before our next or during our next discussion, I think it would be helpful.
Yeah, but get them out to us in advance, Ms. Sharp.
Well,
closing comments.
The only other request that I might make is that going through this, I thought that some of the other themes might be redundant with some of the ones that we've talked about, and just for staff to go back through and really kind of look and see, can we combine any of these? Because I actually counted up the objectives. We had 133. That's way too many. We haven't even gotten to objectives yet. And so I would just ask staff to take another quick look at themes and outcomes and see if any of them make logical sense to combine.
All right. Can I get a thumbs up or thumb down consensus that we will ask staff to spend the time to go back and see where they can consolidate these if possible? Yeah, and that list of definitions. We'll try to work on those in time for the next review of this. Okay.
Mr. Chair, just a question. No, can we just kind of say that this document is kind of null and void because we're going to have a new one, so we don't confuse it? It might be a lot what's in here already, but there's already our first couple have been changed a little bit, so we'll be there a whole new document emailed so we can kind of eliminate so we don't have confusion.
You'll see we'll take all the red lines that you've agreed to up to this point or discussed up to this point since everything's not been agreed to, and we'll start with that.
We only have agreement on
those. but that'll be red line too, so that everyone remembers what got changed from the original.
Right, and possibly the new changes on the
others. Yeah, you'll get something that looks very much like this, except next time there'll be red lines on those things that you talked about.
Because red meant we changed it from, red already got used. Red,
I see what you're saying. Sure, we can do that. Purple it is.
Yep. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are adjourned for the night. Thank you for your time and your patience. Parking validations if you don't want to pay the fine. I saw tickets out there earlier for anybody who's parked on the street.
Hang in there, John.
Job security, man.